Praise God. Isn't the Lord wonderful? Good to be in the Lord's house tonight. You can be seated. We're going to continue our Bible study, talking about God's love. I hope you've enjoyed the first two lessons. There's just so many beautiful scriptures describing God's love to us. And so here is our key verse found in 1 Corinthians 13. And 13, it says, "And now abideth faith, hope, charity. These three. But the greatest of these is charity." And of course, charity is love. And before we start, isn't that nice? Thanksgiving is next Thursday. It has been our tradition that we do not have Bible study on Wednesday night to Thursday right before Thanksgiving, because I know a lot of you ladies like to get started on your cooking, and some people travel to be with family, so that's just how we've always done it over the years. We'll still have our prayer meeting Tuesday night, like normal, but Wednesday night I want to reserve for families. If you're going to travel or you need to start cooking, or if you're going to shopping and you haven't done your shopping yet, it's probably too late. If y'all haven't seen HEB, it's pretty crowded. So hopefully you've already got your food lined up and you know what you're going to cook and you're ready to go. But next Wednesday, I want you to spend time with your family and get ready for Thanksgiving. You know, it's kind of hard to take Thanksgiving out of Thanksgiving. I mean, you can do everything you can to take Christ out of Christmas, right? They do it all the time. They want to take Christ out of Christmas. But you know what? Thanksgiving. Just the name says it all. We have to pause to be thankful. You know, and as you sit around the table, think of something in your life to be thankful for. You have something to be thankful for. Amen? So, and while I'm on that topic, another exciting announcement. This Sunday, we were going to have Brother Plemons here on the 28th, but he had a scheduling change, and he's going to be here this weekend. It's going to be great. Instead of the 28th, it'll just be a regular service. Well, I say just a regular service. There's a local preacher here who preaches on Sunday mornings. Y'all can come hear him. Amen. But this Sunday, we're going to have the wild man. Brother Plemons will be here, and I'm so looking forward to it. Every time I get a chance to be in a service and hear him preach, it's always exciting. So we're looking forward to that this weekend. So invite somebody to come and be a part of what God is doing. So just remember, next Wednesday night, just take your time and cook and be ready to spend time with your family for Thanksgiving. All right, 1 Corinthians 13 and 13. I want you to notice there, I put the Strong's up there for you. And you can see the Greek word number 26, according to Dr. Strong's. Charity is actually that word. What is that word? Agape, right? And they even... They kind of pronounce it there for you so you can see it. Agape, like pay at the end. So they put it there for you. And actually that Talking Strong's Concordance I have is pretty nice, because you just click on it and it will pronounce it in Greek for you. So I really like that. That's a wonderful Bible study tool. But agape is what we're talking about, and it's translated charity in our verse here. So when you look at the 1 Corinthians 13, and when it's talking about love, that is the word, and it's translated as charity, but we speak it today, we say love. When you look it up in the Vines, agape is used to describe the attitude of God, and it really is God's attitude towards us. Aren't you thankful that his attitude towards the human race is one of love? Amen. Some people try to portray God as having this bad attitude towards mankind. He does not have a bad attitude towards mankind. In fact, it's just the exact opposite. What more could he do? He robed himself in flesh. God was manifest in the flesh. He robed himself in flesh because he did not have a body. So a body thou hast prepared me. He robed himself in flesh to shed his blood for the remission of sins. So he came himself and gave his life for us. That's his attitude towards us. It is an attitude of love. And then he uses the word to describe his will to his children concerning their attitude towards one another. We should have the same attitude towards others because God loves them. A new commandment I give unto you in John 13 and 34, that ye love one another as I have loved you. Isn't that how we know who the true Christians are? You will know them by their big bank accounts. You will know them because of their social gatherings. And they cook great barbecue. You will know them by their love. That's how you know the real Christians, right? Watch ye, stand fast in the faith, quit you like men, be strong, and let all your things be done with love. Let everything. Love should be the center of your life. And as you love, and it's like if you put on a pair of rose-colored glasses, everything that you saw would have a rosy view to it, wouldn't it? As they say, he's wearing rose-colored glasses, right? So everything looks rosy. But if you begin to look at the world through his eyes, God, let me look at the world through your eyes. Let me see people not as hopeless basket cases that can never be saved, but let me see them through the eyes of love that says, yes, you can change. You can become a better new creature through Christ. Amen. Through his blood. He can change. He can make the vilest sinner clean. I believe he can do it. We shouldn't give up hope on our families. I believe that. We need to look at them through the eyes of love that says, yes, God can make a difference in your life. We should have compassion. That's what it says. We should have compassion, making a difference. That should be our goal. How do we do it? Through love. And the Lord make you to increase and abound. What does it mean when you think of abound? Like it just keeps getting bigger and bigger, right? Abound in love toward another and toward all men, even as we do toward you, to the end he may establish your hearts unblameable in holiness. So if you want to be established, if you want to grow, if you want to become more like God, how do we do it? Let love grow and increase inside of you. As God is perfecting his love in you. Hey, we're not perfect. And love is not perfect in us yet, but God is perfecting his love in us. His love can drive out fear and worry, right? If we will just allow him, his agape. And he demonstrated it for us when it says, no greater love, there's no greater love. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. They didn't take his life. He gave it, right? He gave his life. What more could he give? Oh, how he loves you. The highest form of love, selfless, sacrificial, unconditional. You think that describes God's love? Always giving, total commitment to seek the highest and the best. God wants what's best for you. The devil will lie to you and say that God is trying to keep things from you. But God knows what's best for you. He protects us even from ourselves. Sometimes when he doesn't answer our prayers, it's for our best. In the respect of agape is used of God, it expresses the deep and constant love and interest of a perfect being towards entirely unworthy objects. And that's true. None of us were saved because we're awesome, because we worked hard, or we paid for it, or we earned it, or we deserve it, right? What was it? It was his love, right? Grace. He gave his amazing grace to us. And as he gives his love to us, what should it do in return? It should cause us to want to have love towards him. We love him because he first loved us, right? As he showed his love towards us, it makes me want to fall in love with him over and over again. Real men love Jesus. Amen? No man has seen God at any time. If we love one another, if we love one another, God dwelleth in us. Ooh, let that sink in for just a minute. If we love one another, you don't have to like me, but you do have to love me. Amen. And his love is perfected in us. So whenever you see perfected, that means that complete. It's finished. God's finishing it. It's not there yet. It's in the process of being perfected in us. But I'm looking forward to when that which is perfect is come. Amen. And by the way, that verse is in the love chapter, 1 Corinthians 13. When that which is perfect is come. Here's another scripture here. It says, there is no fear in love, but perfect love casteth out fear. So as the love of God begins to grow in your heart, and the love of God begins to become the center of your life, the center of your being, your entire life is built and hangs upon this one thing. Love. There's no space for fear anymore. Fear just has to go. Right? It's going to have to leave. It's time to take that giant and just put him out of your life. Right? Fear, doubt, worry, unbelief, these things that are in your life. You know what? Replace it with love. Let love come in and begin to take over your life. Let God perfect his love in you. Now, this is from Sparkling Gems from the Greek, my devotional that I read every morning. And this is talking about the scripture in Romans 8, where it says, I'm persuaded that neither death nor life nor angels nor principalities nor powers nor things present nor things to come nor height nor depth nor any other creature, and it's the part I want to focus in on right there in yellow, shall be able to separate us from the love of God. Right? And so he's going to go in and kind of break that verse down for you in the Greek and show you, bring out some of the highlights of that verse. The words shall be able is from the word dunamai, which describes strength, capacity, or ability. It's the word that we have for dynamite, dunamis. Power. Ye shall receive power. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you, right? So it's that same word there. The shall be able. None of those things that were described there have the power, the strength, the capacity, or the ability to separate. The word separate is chorizo, which means to sunder, to sever, to disunite, to tear apart, to disconnect, to cut off, disengage, or to withdraw. The love of God cannot be pulled asunder from you. The love of God, if you have united it with your heart, there is nothing that has the power, the ability, the dunamis to reach in and tear it apart from you, to cut you off, to disengage you from the love of God. That's what Paul is saying. The love of God is so powerful that there is nothing, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate you from God's love. Notice that Paul says nothing is capable of tearing a believer from the love of God. The word from is the Greek word apo, which means away and implies distance. This clearly means that there is nothing that can put distance between you and God's love. Nothing has the ability to do it, the power, the strength. Nothing can tear or pull or rip or tug. Nothing can get the love of God out of your life. God will never leave you. He will never forsake you. Oh, love of God, how rich and pure, how measureless and strong. I am persuaded. Nothing in this world has enough power to disconnect you from the love of God. No angel, no demon, no government, no creature, no mistake of your own making. Woo! Will ever be capable of cutting you off from the love of God. He still loves you. Even when we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He loves us so much. God's love is greater than man will ever be able to comprehend. It reaches to the highest mountain. It penetrates to the lowest parts of the earth. Regardless of what you are facing in your life today, God's love is with you. Woo! Have you ever been in just a desperately scary situation where all you had was enough time to say, Jesus, Lord, I need you right now. Amen. There's just something about it. You know, you, like they say, there's no atheists in foxholes. Woo! I tell you what, would you hear that bullet go, poof, and you're going, hallelujah, the Lord is my shield. God's love kept me. God is with me. He gave his angels charge over me to watch over me. I can't even began to number how many times the great, powerful love of God penetrated to right where I was at, and he put his love around me like a shield, and he protected me and kept me so that my feet did not slip and fall. He picked me up. He set me upon a rock, and when I made mistakes, he loved me anyway and picked me back up and put me back on my feet and gave me another chance. He restores my soul. Why? Because he loves me. Because he loves you. God's love is with you, and nothing will ever be able to disconnect you. Don't let the devil lie to you. The devil will begin to lie to you and tell you, you are just not worthy. You're not important. God doesn't care. I say this to you. Cast your burden upon the Lord, and he shall sustain you. Wherever you're at, all you have to do is mention his name. His arm is not short that it cannot save. His ear is not heavy that it cannot hear. He can reach out and pick you up wherever you're at. Nothing. Let love be without dissimulation. Abhor that which is evil. cleave to that which is good. And then notice here, be kindly affectioned one to another with brotherly love, in honor, preferring one another. So when you think about that scripture right there, preferring one another, that means you're putting someone else first, right? You're putting others before yourself. And isn't that exactly what agape love is all about? Agape love is caring about others besides just yourself. It's sacrificial. It's self-giving, right? And so the word, this is from your Unger's Bible Dictionary. The only word in the Bible translated charity means love. It is affection, tender, and passionate attachment. A sentiment of our nature excited by qualities in a person or thing that command our affection. And then I noticed this here. I put it in yellow for you. A virtue of such efficacy that it is said to be the fulfilling of the law. Folks, that's not an easy thing to do. To fulfill the law. You're going to mess something up. If you look at Moses' law, you're going to mess something up in there. But here, if you love, you fulfill the law, it says. That's pretty powerful. Christian love is piety, the greatest boon that God can give, for God is love. In it, all human duty is summed up. Love is the first named element in the composite fruit of the Spirit. So there you see, this is in your Unger's Bible Dictionary. So we're going to break some of this down a little bit here and look at it. The whole law is summed up in love. That's what it says right here. Not in the sense of rendering all other requirements as inconsequential, but in the sense that love is fundamental, expresses the spirit of all the others. So it's saying, in order to fulfill the law, you have to love. What is the greatest commandment? You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and your neighbor as yourself. Right? Love. Owe no man anything but to love, for he that loveth another hath fulfilled the law. Romans 13 and 8. That's just a beautiful scripture there. If ye love me, keep my commandments. That's what Jesus said. If ye love me, if ye love me. And then I put this here so you could see. You are capable of agape. There you see the number 25. That's agape. If ye love me, if you have agape towards me, self-sacrificing, putting God first. That's what agape is all about. It's giving sacrificially of yourself for another. Oh, when's the last time you laid your body upon the altar and said, God, I love you so much, I give you my heart. Lord, I give you my soul. Lord, I love you so much that I give you my mind. Lord, I love you so much I give you all of my strength. I lay myself upon the altar. I present my body a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God. I offer the sacrifice of praise, the fruit of my lips, giving thanks to your name. Why? Because I love you. When's the last time you said, Lord, I love you? I realize this is not a jump on that chandelier and start swinging around kind of a lesson. This is a look down into your heart. and say, Lord, I'd like to sit on the back porch swing with you for a while and just talk. You know, when you're with somebody that you really, really love, it just seems like the evening just goes by so fast. When you're in love with God, prayer meeting just takes a moment. Otherwise, it's... But when you're in love with God, you know, living for God is easy when you live for Him hard. Right? It's easy to live for God when you live for Him with all your heart. It's hard to live for God if you try to do it easy. Christian love. It is also important to note that it is made possible only by divine grace. I believe that we cannot truly understand what love is until the Holy Ghost begins to open our mind and reveal it to us. He said in 1 John 3:16, hereby perceive we the love of God, because He laid down His life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. When you look at that same passage in the Amplified, they kind of bring it out. It says, by this we come to know. And then when you see those parentheses there, they're going to zoom in on that word come to know, and they're going to make it, they're going to amplify it so you can understand the word better. By this we come to know, progressively to recognize, to perceive, to understand the essential love. Hereby we perceive we the love of God. Hereby. How do we do it? The Holy Spirit opens our mind and begins to reveal who God really is. I tell you, it was an eye-opening experience for me when I realized, and I appreciated so much what Brother Treadwell was saying Sunday morning. When I was a child and I went to the Methodist church with my grandmother, and they would pray, and they would pray. They literally believe, I don't care what they're telling you, they literally believe they're praying to three different people. They do. They believe it's three different people, right? So you need to pray 5 minutes to this person, 5 minutes to this person, 5 minutes to this person, because you don't want to offend the other one. And I was praying as a childlike faith. This is how God opened my eyes. These three are one. We don't have to pray to three different gods. When we get to heaven, there won't be three different thrones. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. He said, I am Lord, and beside me there is no Savior. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. Now, either the God of the Old Testament is the Savior, like He said, and He was born in Jerusalem, or I'm just not understanding that Scripture. But I understand that Scripture completely. There is no God else beside Him. He said, unto me every knee will bow. Unto me. And I know that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. But you know, to understand this, we have to have the Holy Ghost reveal this to us. This scripture here is telling us we perceive the love of God. God begins to reveal to us just how much He loves us. All of a sudden, one day the light came on and I realized, God did not send the second person of a three-part Trinity to earth to die, while the other two parts stayed up in heaven and watched. God robed himself in flesh, dwelt among us, and gave his very life for us. That's how we perceive the love of God. God didn't send someone else to die. He came himself and died so that I could be saved. Love. For God so loved. I have loved you with an everlasting love. Therefore, I have drawn you with loving kindness. Jeremiah 31 and 3. God's everlasting love drawing us. Aren't you thankful that his love doesn't stop? Amen. The batteries don't run down. Amen. God has all power. Right? He's never weary. There's no searching of his understanding. He that keepeth Israel neither slumbers nor sleeps. He's watching over you 24 hours a day, and he loves you. God's everlasting love. That you might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work, and increasing the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might according to his glorious power unto all patience and long-suffering with joyfulness. When you look at that picture, think of fruitful, right? You're being fruitful. And so immediately I think of the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. The fruit of the Spirit. These things should be abounding in your life. And when you look up the fruit of the fruit of the Spirit is love, and there you see it, 26, agape. Brother Wolf, why do you keep showing me all these scriptures about agape? Because God wants you to have agape in you. He wants it to be fruitful in you. He wants it to abound in you. He wants it to grow in you. You know what? If you have more of the love of God in you, you'll be less critical of people. You'll be less condemning. You'll begin to look at other people and you'll realize, you know, if it had not been for Jesus, where would I be? Oh, I'm going to give that person a break right here because God gave me a break. Woo, that's okay. You know, when you look at scriptures like that and God begins to speak to your heart, it just comes right down to where you live. I want to have love in my life because God had love for me. I don't want to condemn others because God did not condemn me. There is therefore now no condemnation. You hear that? No condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus. I'm so thankful that He did not send his son into the world to condemn the world. The world was condemned already. But he came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief. Paul jumped on that when he said, I'm chief. Don't even try it. Of whom I am chief. The fruit of the righteous is a tree of life, and he that winneth souls is wise. Have you ever had some fruit where you take a bite of it and you go, man, that was so good, I want some more? Right? Taste and see that the Lord is good. I tell you, when people come into our service, if they experience love, guess what they're going to want to do? Come back and get some more. The fruit of the righteous is a tree of life. I want this to be a tree of life right here. People who are down and out, down on their luck, discouraged, depressed, I want them to be able to come to the lighthouse of hope and find love. No condemnation. Forgiveness, mercy at the cross. Amen. The fruit of the righteous is a tree of life. And he that winneth souls is wise. You know how you're going to win souls? Love. You're going to love them into the truth. You can know all the scriptures in the world, but if you take the scriptures and you go, right? You ever been around anybody like that? They pick up their Bible, and when they say sword, literally, they want to hit people with it. It's all in the presentation. That is so right. If you have a spirit of love, they can feel the spirit of love coming out of you, and you're leading them to the tree of life. He that winneth souls is wise, and you're going to win them by loving them into the truth. And when they see the love, they'll know. Amen. That's what's going to draw. What's going to draw people is when they see the fruit in your life. You shall know them by their fruit. Amen. I don't want to be a lemon. Woo. Bitter, sour. Amen. But I want people to, like that cluster of grapes right there. You eat one of those big grapes, you're thinking, I want another one. A fruitful life. The fruit of the Spirit. Love should be abounding. Love should be growing. Can you tell that you're a more loving person? If you look back where you were a year ago and look at where you're at today and say, do I have more of a heart of love? Or is my heart closed? Bitter, angry, hurt, resentful. Oh, I want those things out of my heart. Replace it, God, with your love. Let love abound more and more in you. The fruit of the Spirit, love. Agape, an undefeatable benevolence, an unconquerable goodwill that always seeks the highest of others, no matter what he does. There you see it. It's undefeatable benevolence to do good. Isn't that what Jesus did? He went about doing good. He loved. He cared. He's always reaching out and wanting people to get to a higher place in their walk with God. And that's what they should sense when they come to the church. They should feel like it's a place of hope, welcoming, and love. Folks, that's just good, solid teaching right there. If you want to see this church grow, it's going to be because we love people. When people come in here, they need to feel the love of God. The love of God will draw them. God's love for man, for God so loved the world. And then you see in Mark 12 and 30, man's love for God. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart. But then don't forget the third part there, Galatians 5 and 14. Man's love for his fellow man. For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even in this: thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Folks, that's right out of your Bible. Love your neighbor. Amen. We should love people into the truth. In Matthew 22 and 36, it says, Master, which is the great commandment in the law? Jesus said unto him, thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, and with all thy soul, and with all thy mind. This is the first and great commandment. And the second is like unto it. Thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. And then he takes it a step further and says, on these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. That's like the foundation, cornerstone upon which everything rests is love. Right? Accordingly, love is to declare to be the chief test of Christian discipleship. This is in your Ungers. Also, love is the highest motive or ground of moral action. Without this, all other motives fall short of furnishing the true stimulus of Christian living. Remember, the love of money is the root of all evil, right? As all sin roots itself in selfishness, so all virtue springs out of love. Let that sink in for a minute. Just like the love of money is the root of all evil, all virtue springs forth from love. The basis of all Christian living, the basis of the law, the basis of everything is love. The greatest. And now abideth faith, hope, and charity. The greatest of these is charity. What is agape? Love the Lord with all your heart and soul and mind and strength, right? Listen to this statement here. To fall in love with God is the greatest romance. To seek Him, the greatest adventure. To find Him, the greatest human achievement. Woo. The greatest human achievement that you can ever do, to find Him. Love. This is from our superintendent, Brother Bernard. It's called Falling in Love. Love is more than infatuation. Sometimes people get excited, and that excitement lasts a week. That's not love. That's not true love. Sometimes people don't like to think this, but love can sneak up on you. I've entitled this message, Falling in Love, but that's probably not the best description. The phrase reminds me of two people walking around in a field. All of a sudden, they come to a ditch, but they aren't watching where they're going, and so they fall in and are covered in mud. They fell in love. That's not really the way it happens. Actually, we choose to love. Some may say, I didn't choose love, but actually, the small choices that they made every day led them to love. When you choose to spend time with someone, talk with someone, share with someone, love may grow gradually until eventually you realize that you're in love. I'm not saying that people plan a strategy, but I'm saying love is an act of the will. You choose to fall in love. It is a progressive way of life. My point is that when we fall in love with Jesus Christ, it's got to be more than infatuation. Some people come to the Lord, they feel excitement, and they say, I want to be a part of this, but the feeling only lasts a week. What we must do is make some commitments, even regarding things that we may not like at first about the Lord or about the church. Notice that there may be some things you don't understand or like about the church at first. Some people say, I don't know if I want to be like those people. I'm scared of that. I don't know if I want to make that commitment. That's a common reaction. But we must keep pressing on. Some say, I don't agree with that. I'm not sure about speaking in tongues. I'm not sure about the importance of Jesus' name. I'm not sure about holiness of life. I'm not sure about all this boisterous worship. But go beneath the surface. Give the Lord a chance. Think about it. Pray about it. And linger near. If you will make some good choices, love will grow. The things you did not understand, you will understand. The things you did not appreciate may become the very things you appreciate the most. Because love is a way of life. Love is a progression. Love will go into the depths of your soul. Beautiful. Amen. There's a lot of things we don't understand at first, but by and by, God reveals it to us and we understand what He's wanting to show us. I'm running out of time here, folks. It's fixing to be 8 o'clock. We must love the Lord our God with all your heart. You know what that is? That's a choice. You choose to love the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. And I'm going to just pause right here because I'm fixing to get into 1 Corinthians 13, and there's some things I was wanting to bring out in there. Let's stand right here. Take a moment and open your heart and say, Lord, I am ready. I am ready, Lord, for whatever it is that you have for me. I am ready, Lord, to draw closer to you. I'm ready, Lord, to make a commitment. I'm ready, Lord, to seek your face in prayer, whatever it takes, God. I'm ready, Lord, ready to fall in love with you. Oh, how about it? Are you ready to give of yourself sacrificially? Agape love. That means you dig deep in your life. You open up every door. Open up every door and just say, Lord, I give myself completely to you, Lord. I've tried everything else. I'm ready to give you a chance, Lord, to be the Lord of my life. I'm ready to surrender complete control to you, God. And as you do that, you will realize that you are falling in love with Him. You're coming to depend upon Him, to lean upon Him, to trust in Him. And pretty soon you'll find out that you can't make it without Him.
This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me. And I
desperate for.
We thank you tonight, Lord, for your presence, for your power, for your word.
How many of you are hungry for God?
Hallelujah, God. I just ask you to be with each precious soul that's here. Keep them. Keep your hand upon them, and in your love, watch over them. Bless them in all that they do. And Lord, help us all to allow love to abound more and more in our hearts so we can become more like you, God. You are love. Help us to be more like Jesus. Let the fruit of the Spirit, love, abound in our lives. We ask these things in the all-powerful name of Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen.